In the previous video, we improved our blinking LED source code and learned about device tree overlays. In this video, we'll update our Zephyr application to toggle the LED state at the push of a button. When we push the tactile switch down, sometimes referred to as depressing the button, the LED should change its state. Importantly, we don't want the LED state to change when we release the button. To toggle the LED again, we should push or depress the button again. There are several ways to achieve this goal, but our application will trigger an interrupt in Zephyr when we push the button down. The interrupt service routine will toggle the LED state and return from the interrupt. This is the circuit we'll use. Our LED is still connected the same way as in previous videos. The tactile switch is connected to GPIO pin 13 on the ESP32, which is physical pin 16, through a debouncing circuit. I've not shown the debouncing circuit, in order to simplify the drawing and focus on the interrupt side of things. But if you're interested, it's based on figure 1217 in the third edition of Art of Electronics by Horowitz and Hill. To get a fast signal edge, Horowitz and Hill uses the hysteresis in a Schmitt trigger inverter. However, with no Schmitt trigger ICs lying around, the trigger and threshold of the 555 IC works just fine. If you're interested in learning more about using the 555 IC like this, there's a link in the description to a nice video on the topic. Debouncing switches is a big topic in its own right, so if you'd like me to explain the debouncing circuit in more detail, please let me know in the comments section. Enough bouncing around, and with the hardware done, let's update the firmware next. First, let's define the button in the device tree overlay file. Call the first group node Buttons. The appropriate compatible is again a generic one, GPIO Keys. Name the actual button node Button, and call the node label the same. Not very imaginative, I know, so feel free to call them something else if you really want to. Where can we see which properties are required? That's right, in the corresponding gpiokeys.yaml file. Turns out that we need a gpios property. We're already familiar with those, and let's use gpio pin 13, which is on the gpio0 controller. We'll make it active high, just like the LED. You might have noticed in the circuit diagram that the switch is connected to ground, not VCC. So shouldn't this be active low instead? The reason is that the 555 chip will invert the output signal. Hopefully that makes sense. And again, let me know if you're unfamiliar with switch debouncing and would like me to go into more details in a separate video about this. We could also activate the internal pull-up resistor by specifying a flag. However, the ESP32's internal pull-up resistors are typically 45 kilo-ohms. And for our circuit, a smaller value worked better. So we've included a physical pull-up resistor on the breadboard instead. That's it. Let's save the overlay file and go into the main.c file. Now that we have a node in the device tree, let's declare a GPIO DT spec struct called button, just like we did with the LED. Also, just like the LED, we need to check that the device is ready and configure the pin. But this time as a GPIO input instead of GPIO output. Then come the new parts. it takes three API calls to set up the interrupt. The first is to call GPIO pin interrupt configure DT with a reference to the GPIO DT spec struct. We then indicate what kind of event should trigger the interrupt. In this example, we'll trigger on the rising edge. But instead of hard coding GPIO int edge rising into our firmware, we just indicate GPIO int edge 2 active, so that if our button becomes active low in the device tree in the future, our code still works. With a proper switch debound circuit, triggering on an edge using interrupts should work fine. However, there have been a few issues related to ESP32 GPIO triggering in the past, and one of the recommendations from Espressif is to trigger on the level instead of the edge. I've linked to a few discussions and an errata from Espressif in the description if you'd like to investigate further. In my experience, as long as my edge is fast enough, it samples fine. Similarly to ESPIDF, the interrupt requires a callback function to be registered. In Zephyr, we call the GPIO init callback function. This function populates the members of a GPIO callback struct, which is also the first argument. The next two arguments are used to populate the members of that struct with the function callback and a bit mask for which GPIO pin should trigger the interrupt. The pin is defined in the device tree overlay, so a call to button.pin given as argument to the bit macro will produce the appropriate bit mask. Then, to activate the interrupt, call GPIO add callback, providing the device struct and callback function reference. I think of this function as enabling the interrupt. To disable the interrupt, we call the GPIO remove callback function. But there's no need for that in our sample application. Now that the interrupt is set up, we need to define the actual callback function that'll be called when the interrupt triggers. The callback will receive three arguments: a device struct, and we learned about those in video 1, the GPIO callback struct that we just populated with the GPIO init callback function call, and the GPIO pin, which we also configured in the initialization. Move the existing LED toggle code into the callback function, and we're done. Before building and flashing the updated code, there's another change we should make. The Zephyr project is very active, and there are frequent changes to the Zephyr source code. One of the changes in the last couple of weeks is to prefer to include the kernel.h header file instead of the zephyr.h header file. So why don't we update our code accordingly? There's no need to perform any other actions, as the two files are equivalent at this point in time. You can have a look at the patch in GitHub if you're interested in more details. I've included a link to the pull request in the description. Build, flash, and test whether it works. And it does. I don't know about you, but there's something strangely satisfying about a responsive switch that works exactly like you expect it to. In general, it's good to try to make the ISR as short as possible and spin off any long-running tasks to a separate thread. In the next video, we'll investigate the pulse width modulation driver to create more interesting LED displays.